All right, so today we're going to talk about transistors, and we're really going to talk about one type of transistor. Let me just outline kind of the big picture of transistors. There's two main types of transistors. There's the bipolar junction transistor, that's what we're going to talk about today. And there's the field effect transistor, which we'll talk about in some future class, mostly when we deal with digital electronics. So historically, the bipolar junction transistors have been more prominent in analog electronics, where you're putting in sine waves and building amplifiers and things. And the field effect transistors have been more prominent in digital electronics. Although nowadays that's changing a little bit. Both work. You know, you could have bipolar junction transistors in digital circuits, and a lot of analog circuits these days, if they're integrated onto chips, they're made from field effect transistors. Now, these work a little bit differently, and I'm not going to go into the physics too deeply, but since we're only going to deal with bipolar junction transistors today, I'm going to talk about that. A diode, let me remind you what a diode was. I don't know if I talked about this too much. A diode was a piece of silicon where half of it was doped with an element like boron that has fewer valence electrons in silicon. And half of it was doped with an element like phosphorus with an extra valence electron compared to silicon. And this would make a positive, the boron would suck electrons out of the swarm and leave holes behind. So this is P doped, positive doped. And the phosphorus down here has extra electrons, so there would be extra negative electrons floating around in the soup. And today we're going to talk about bipolar junction transistors. And a bipolar junction transistor, you can have either an NPN transistor, which is the kind we'll work with today, or a PNP transistor. And what I'm not drawing here is super important for the operation of transistors. It's that this middle region is really incredibly tiny. So it's so tiny that the interesting part of the transistor action is having current go through this middle region, even though it wouldn't go through it if it were just two diodes back to back. So the first transistor we're going to look at is symbol's going to look like that. And this is going to be called the base, and it's going to be called the emitter because it is an emitter of electrons, even though that's confusing because you normally think about positive charges. It's going to be a collector because it collects electrons. This is not exactly equivalent to back-to-back diodes. So this arrow on the bottom kind of indicates that there's a diode-like thing pointing that direction. So here's your base, here's your emitter. And there's, because of its transistor structure, there's a diode-like thing pointing in this direction. But again, you can't build a transistor out of back-to-back diodes because you don't have this special, extremely thin region in the center where all the kind of amplification magic crossing over happens. But if you pull a transistor out of your kit, the first thing you can do is test it with a diode meter and see that the transistor acts like this. This is going to be an NPN transistor. So actually the first thing you'll do is probably test it in your component tester. You'll stick it in and hit the button, and it'll tell you what kind of transistor it is, and it'll tell you which pins correspond to the base, which correspond to the collector, which correspond to the emitter. And then you'll probe it with a diode meter and see that it does, as long as you're not doing anything transistory with it, it does act like two diodes. These aren't particularly great diodes, especially this base collector diode, because it's really meant to be run backwards. I'll show you why in a second. So in normal operation, let me just draw the symbol here. I can just extend this one. So the important thing to remember is that transistors aren't batteries. They're going to be amplifiers. They're going to amplify something, but they're not making power where there was no power before. In the water analogy, they're more like valves. They're not pumps, they're valves. So you need some source of potential up here to allow the charges to flow down. All right, so let me label a whole bunch of things here. And these are just going to be currents and voltages. So one thing that's complicated about transistors is there's three wires coming off. And so you have to deal with three different currents. It's not like a resistor or a capacitor where every bit of current that came in one side came out the other side. Here, you have to be a little bit more careful about how you label things. So there's gonna be some base current, I sub B, that goes in, and some base voltage, V sub B, that this base is being held at. There's gonna be some IE that comes down, and maybe this voltage here is gonna be VE. And there's gonna be some IC that goes down here, and the voltage here is gonna be VC. And again, this is called the emitter because it's emitting electrons, even though all the sort of conventional positively charged current is going this way. It's emitting electrons, it's collecting electrons here. All right, so let me just describe how this works. And then I'll put it in a couple circuits in a little bit. So how does this device act? Well, there are sort of two conditions or two assumptions, two conditions that you need to hold. Now let me say, if both of these things hold, one and two, then something is true. So condition number one is basically that this diode here, the BE diode, is on. So what that means is that VB has to be bigger than around 0.6 volts plus VE. So that just means you need the voltage here has to be high enough to allow current to start flowing through this diode. That's condition number one. Condition number two, and the book describes it as things are arranged. Let me just say what it is. Condition number two is that the collector voltage here, VC, has to be bigger than the emitter voltage. So this top voltage has to be bigger than this bottom voltage by at least a few tenths of a volt. So that's not hard to arrange in all the circuits that we're gonna draw. You know, that if this thing is really gonna act like a valve to let current flow down, it's sort of obvious that the potential up on top has to be bigger than the potential down here in order for current to flow down through this valve. So if that's the case, then the transistor magic happens. Then IC, the current that's flowing down through the top, is equal to this constant beta times IB, the current that's flowing in. And beta is somewhere between 50 to 200. Oftentimes when I talk about it, I'm gonna just say beta is about 100. Now this beta depends on the particular transistor. It depends on the model of transistor that you buy. It depends on the particular one that you pull out of the batch. So you have sort of big power transistors, which tend to have low betas, but they can support more current. And the little signal transistors, which tend to have higher betas, but they can't take as much current. And even within the batch, you'll pull out different ones and their betas will be slightly different. Beta also depends on the temperature, depends on exactly how much current you're flowing through. So we don't really want to design our circuits to be dependent on a very specific value of beta. We just want to treat beta as being a big number around 100. And so what happens is you inject a little bit of base current and 100 times as much current flows into here. Now, of course, nothing ever builds up. So the emitter current, i.e. the current that comes out has to equal the sum of the currents that come in, IB plus IC. And if I write IC as beta times IB, this is beta plus one IB, which is pretty close to just beta times IB, because beta is about 100. So again, to within 1%, all the current that comes in from the top comes out the bottom. So you could think about this as a tiny little pipe as letting a little bit of current come in into the base of some big valve. And that's letting a huge current, controlling a huge current that's 100 times bigger, flow down through this valve. That's a sort of picture that I want you to have in your head for these transistors. And the key is to just arrange the circuit so that these two conditions hold, and arrange the circuit so that you can take advantage of this gain. Because this is a gain in current, but again, the thing we care about is voltage. So we'll design some circuits to manipulate voltages and do some other things with voltages. All right, so are there any questions about that? Just the basic, did I say anything incorrect, I guess? That's obvious from, did I say anything inconsistent?
Oh, just checking.
Yes.
So for a larger beta, it takes a smaller amount of current?
No,
or backwards.
I'm just saying that big fat metal transistors that are made for handling lots of current tend to have smaller betas.
Okay, cool.
Tiny little transistors that are meant for just amplifying little signals tend to have higher betas. I don't know if that's a law of physics or a law of economics, but certainly the ones in your kit follow that trend. So the big ones with a big metal back tend to have betas around 50. The tiny ones that we'll use today tend to have betas 200, around the 200 range. But you know, when we sort of think about designing circuits, I'm always just going to say about 100. And the goal is to design circuits where this exact value doesn't matter. All right, so I'm going to need a minute to erase the board. Then you can ask questions while I'm erasing. So we'll talk about three circuits today that use the transistor. Let me leave these rules here for when I talk about the first circuit. I'll erase this too so I have some room. So our first circuit we're going to design is going to be a current source. So like I said, normally we have and manipulate voltages, but you know, I think it's easiest to build these up one at a time. And the first one's going to be a current source. And so the goal of a current source is to have a constant current through some load resistor, RL, even as you change, the load resistor. So imagine turning the knob on your potentiometer to increase and decrease the resistance. And the goal is to keep the same amount of current through here. And let me just draw the circuit and then we'll step through how it works. So all these circuits start with a transistor. So I'll draw that. And this one's gonna have a resistor connected to its emitter down here. I'll call this 5K for my example. I'm gonna have a voltage here, which I'm gonna assign to be 5.6 volts. So imagine you have some other power supply that you can set to 5.6 volts. I'm gonna put my load resistor up here. This is my load resistor. And I'm gonna connect the top here. For this example, let's connect it to 20 volts. So your power supplies only go up to 5. So these are all higher voltages than you can make, but this will make the math a little bit easier. So let's step through this piece by piece, and I'm gonna number the pieces. So piece number one is, what is the voltage here at the emitter? Well, the voltage at the emitter, if this is 5.6 volts and this is a diode, then certainly current can flow through the diode down to ground. So this diode is on, and when a diode is on, this is all silicon. So when the silicon diode is on, there's a 0.6 volt drop. You start out at 5.6, you go down by 0.6. That means that the first step is that, step number one, this is gonna be 5 volts. Okay, so step number two is, what is the current coming out of the emitter going through this 5K resistor? Well, if there's 5 volts up here and 5 kilo ohms down here, this is just gonna be 1 milliamp of current going down here. All right, so step number three is to look up here. Step number three is to say, well, if 1 milliamp flows here, where's that 1 milliamp coming from? 1 milliamp better be coming from up here, because only 1/100th of that, only 1 beta-th of that is coming in here. So IC is really close to 1 milliamp. It's within 1 beta-th of 1 milliamp. And notice that that's true regardless of what this resistor is. So nowhere in this analysis did this resistor even come into play. It's just current conservation and the transistor acting like this valve that's letting through some amount. And notice that the actual value of beta didn't matter either. When we set our current, basically with this combination of voltage and this resistor here. That's how we set our 1 milliamp. As long as beta is big, the current that's coming in here is going to be pretty damn close to what we set down here. Now, there's one issue with this circuit. So you might ask, yeah, what happens if you make RL really tiny? You know, RL zero, is that fine? Yeah, that's fine. If RL is 0 ohms, if you replace that just with a wire or just with your meter, that's fine. This is sort of the one instance when you have a current source, it's the one instance where low resistors are just fine, because this transistor is limiting the current to be 1 milliamp, no more. Let me ask, the fourth stage of the analysis is where things get a little bit tricky with the load resistor. What is the voltage here, the voltage at the collector? And this has to do with how big RL can get. So can RL get small? Yeah, RL can go all the way down to zero, but how big can RL get? Well, what is VC? The voltage here is going to be 20 volts minus whatever voltage is dropped across this resistor. So minus 1 milliamp times RL. And so if RL is 1 kilo ohm, it's going to be 20 minus 1. If RL is 2 kilo ohms, it's going to be 20 minus 2. And as I keep increasing RL to be bigger and bigger and bigger, as long as this thing is keeping a constant current, this voltage here is going to go lower and lower and lower. But we have to look at our rules here. Eventually, the voltage on top can't go below the voltage on the bottom, right? In order for the transistor to work properly, the potential right on top here has to be higher than the potential below. So as we increase RL, there eventually comes a limit where we really bump up against the voltage here. So the voltage here is 5 volts. So this has to be bigger than 5 volts. So we have to say that this is bigger than about 5 volts. And maybe if we wanted to be really careful, we would say bigger than 5.5, bigger than 6 volts, but the absolute hard limit is 5 volts. And you could solve for this. So this would be 15 volts, has to be bigger than or equal to 1 milliamp times RL. I can divide. I can see that RL has to be less than or equal to 15 kilo ohms. So as long as my RL is tiny, as long as less than 15 kilo ohms, you can change RL by dialing in this dial up and down, up and down, up and down. And this voltage will adjust in order to keep 1 milliamp flowing through up to this 1% correction here. So this is our current source. You will build this today. This will probably be the second circuit you build because of the way the lab is written. I'd say it's one of the easier ones to analyze in terms of these four steps here. And they call this step number 4. Let me take questions on the current source. The next circuit that we're going to talk about, this is called the common emitter amplifier. And so this is going to be our first amplifier. It's going to amplify voltages, but specifically it's going to amplify wiggles on an input voltage. So what do I mean by that? Well, let's imagine you have, this is a function of time, and this is V in. We're gonna have to set V in to be some average level that might not be zero for this circuit. And then if we put a sine wave on top of that, then our V out is gonna be a bigger version that's gonna be somewhere else. Let's say for this circuit, it's actually somewhere else, higher. And it's gonna be a bigger sine wave. And in fact, we'll find that it's inverted. So it's actually gonna be a bigger sine wave that we might do this. And so the amplitude of this voltage versus the amplitude of the input, that's what we're hoping to amplify. Now, starting next time and the time after that, we'll sort of release some of these restrictions where you have to offset your inputs and offset your outputs and deal with all that. We'll eventually build amplifiers that are basically ideal once we get to 2 weeks from now with op amps. But for now, this is our first circuit that actually makes a signal bigger than what you put in. And I'm going to draw it, and it is going to look exactly like the current source. We're just going to interpret things a little bit differently. So here's our V in, and here's our, oops, here's our transistor. And I'm going to have an RE that I'm just going to leave unspecified for now, connected to ground. And I'm going to have an RC. Which I'm not going to connect. And then I'm going to have a power supply. Let's say you have 5-volt power supply. So I'm going to, you can call it V plus, or for you, it's going to be 5 volts for your 5-volt power supply. All right. So let me call this size of this wiggle delta V in. And the goal is to find the size of this wiggle, amplitude of this wiggle, delta V out. And I'm not going to worry too much about the offsets. Why is that? Well, first thing, I have to pick an offset so that this voltage is high enough to turn this diode on. So this offset, if the diode's going to be on, this, the lowest that V in can go, let me draw like this. The lowest V in can go has to be above 0.6 volts, right? So the V in can never dip below that, or this transistor is going to turn off. So V in is hovering up, you know, somewhere, maybe a volt, maybe 2 volts. And there's a little wiggle on top, some sinusoidal, or it could be triangle wave. It could be anything, any sort of wiggle on top. And so let's go through the analysis here. So first step number one is to wiggle V in. Wiggle V in by some delta V in. All right, so what happens here? That's happens here. Step number two, step number two in this analysis is that VE, the voltage here at the emitter, and I'm gonna draw a great emitter here. The voltage at this emitter wiggles. This is V in minus 0.6 volts. But the wiggles in V in, delta V emitter, are the same as the wiggles in V in. So you can imagine taking some derivative in the limit of very tiny wiggles. There's this constant voltage offset, which isn't going to affect things, but small wiggles in Vin are going to cause small wiggles in VE. So this is going to wiggle by the same amount. So far we haven't done anything. Step number three is to ask about the current here. So what is IE? IE is VE over RE. So it's the voltage here divided by the resistor here. RE is fixed. So if we wiggle VE a little bit, we're going to be wiggling this current by, some amount. And I can just relate this to delta V in. Or RE. Okay, so far no magic has happened. The transistor action happens just like the current source. If the current down here changes, the current up here, step number four, is that the current up here, IC, is going to wiggle by the same amount. To 1/beta corrections. So, to about 1%, delta IC is pretty close to delta IE, which is delta VN over RE. Okay. Now, step number five is the voltage across this RC. Let's call it VRC. Step number five is that the voltage across here, VRC, this is IC, current through it, times RC, and it's going to wiggle by delta VRC. We're going to wiggle by the same, it's going to be RC times the wiggle in IC. The wiggle in IC is this. This is going to be delta VN times the ratio of RC over RE. Ah, okay. So here we're starting to get some amplification. If we make RC 10 times bigger than RE, for example, so this is 10K and 1K, then our wiggles across this resistor here are going to be 10 times bigger than our input wiggles. So if you're measuring the voltage across this transistor, then you've already got an amplifier. Step six, though, we always measure voltages with respect to ground. So step six is to look at the voltage here. And the voltage here is going to be, so this is called VC, the voltage at the collector, at the top of the transistor. This is going to be our input voltage, V plus, our power supply voltage, minus the voltage across this resistor. So you start out at 5 volts, you go down by this amount. And if we were to ask for what are the wiggles here, delta VCs, well, this 5 volt power supply better not change, otherwise it's not a very good power supply. This is minus delta VRC. So this is minus delta VN times RC over RE. All right, and this is going to be our wiggle on V out. And this is where we get our amplification factor and our minus sign. And where the average of this line happens to live, that's dictated by solving this whole circuit in the average case where you're not wiggling. So you have some V in, you go down by 0.6, you figure out the current through here, you go down from there. So you could run this whole analysis to figure out what the constant line is. But the point is that we're amplifying these wiggles. We're taking some small delta V in, and if RC is bigger than RE, we can amplify the wiggles by a factor that's bigger than one. Or we could shrink them by some factor, but if you're going to shrink them, you might as well just use a voltage divider. All right, so let me, I guess maybe I should have specified, this is where we're going to take our V out. So this is our out in here for this circuit. All right, so did all six of those steps make sense, even though it's sort of a long chain of reasoning? This is all gone over in the book if this went by a little too fast. But you'll build the circuit and play around with it, and hopefully as you build it, you can write out a little bit of math. Okay, so before I talk about the last circuit, let me motivate it a little bit, because I would say it's sort of the hardest one to, it's the easiest one to understand, but it's the hardest one to understand why you care. So let me to show you two different dividers here. So one divider has a 10 volt input and two 1K resistors and ground, and this is our output. Another divider, also 10 volts. Here we have 100K resistors. 100K. Ground. There's our output. All right, so So what's the difference between these? Well, it looks like they both divide the 10 volts in half, right? And so both of these give you 5 volts. So why would you choose one as opposed to another? Well, this comes when you want to add an additional stage on here. So say this was just one intermediate step in a much longer chain. Now let's say in the next step, you wanted to have another divider, and that divider was a 10K divider. So this is kind of stupid to divide and then divide again, but imagine that this is just a simpler model for something more complicated. Or you were just given this and you needed to divide the output again. You couldn't go in and muck with the circuit. Now, if you add your second stage here, these circuits are going to look a little bit different. And from thinking back in the first class, we thought about the Thevenin equivalent of this circuit. So it's a circuit with a wire coming out. So we can draw a black box around it. And ask, what is the Thevenin equivalent of this? It has some, so this should equal a different black box where there's some V Thevenin and R Thevenin. Let me draw this a little bit differently so that it makes more sense when we hook it up to things. So, say V Thevenin R Thevenin, and that's what comes out. And our next stage, the thing we want to hook it to, it's also some black box. And it's a black box, which is just a device with some input impedance, Zn. Now for this circuit, we can calculate everything that's going on. And same thing for this circuit. So let me just draw that here. There's a box for the second circuit. There's V Thevenin and R Thevenin coming out. And our second stage is going to be a box. With some Z in, some input impedance. Why is it an input impedance? Because you're looking into the box. This Thevenin equivalent is only for resistors, basically. In general, the thing that comes out of the box, the resistor that comes out of the box is called an output impedance. So in both cases, the Thevenin voltage here is going to be whatever voltage you measure when you don't connect the load. So this is our load in this case, our next stage, and this is our load in this case. So if you don't connect this load, you measure 5 volts here. Same thing here, if you don't connect the model of the load, you would measure V Thevenin, because there would be some V Thevenin and no currents flowing, because you haven't connected anything. So R Thevenin doesn't matter. So here, V Thevenin is 5 volts, and here V Thevenin is also 5 volts. The difference is R Thevenin. So if you were to work out what the equivalent of this is, like I said before, this looks like even though these resistors are in series, if you work out the Thevenin equivalent, it ends up being the parallel combination of those two resistors. So for this box, the parallel combination of two 1Ks is half of 1K. So R Thevenin is 500 ohms. And here, the parallel combination of 200 Ks, this is 50K. And for both cases, our load is just going to be these two resistors in series. So our input impedance for this load is going to be 20K, and our input impedance for this load is going to be 20K. So this should all be somewhat of a review from the first day. But now, if you connect this up, it's like connecting this 20K up to a battery whose internal resistance is 500 ohms. You're going to form a voltage divider, but it's a divider with 500 here and 20K here. And so this isn't going to divide the voltage very much. You can connect this up and it'll lower the voltage here a little bit, but not too much. Whereas if you connect this up, now you have a divider between 50K and 20K. It's going to totally load this circuit. You're not going to have 5 volts anymore. You're going to have something closer to 2 volts. So that's the difference between a divider with a low output impedance, like 500 ohms, and a divider with a high output impedance, like 50K. So obviously low output impedance is better. It's like a low internal resistance to a battery. And the higher the input impedance is, the easier it is for some circuit to drive the next stage without being affected itself. So it's easy to drive these 20Ks for this circuit. If I had gone with 100 ohms, then I would be in the same situation as I was over here. This would quash this voltage here. So when we think about designing circuits in stages, we always have to think about what is the output impedance of this stage and what is the input impedance of the next stage. And our rule, if we want to keep everything within 10%, we want to connect a stage to a circuit and not affect it by more than 10%. Our rule is that the input impedance to the next stage always has to be 10 times bigger than the output impedance of the previous stage. So 10 times 500 ohms would be 5K. And this input impedance is bigger than 5K, so we're good here. 10 times 50K is 500K. We're not good here. The attaching this second stage is going to affect this output here. So in general, if you have a big circuit, we'd like to design it in multiple stages. But if at every stage you have to increase your impedance by at least 10, eventually you're going to run out of resistors. And I can't go very many stages before I get to one mega ohm, 10 mega ohm. That's pretty much it. We don't have bigger resistors. And even if we did, those resistors would end up giving you so little current that things would become incredibly noisy and really hard to measure. So we need something that can intervene here. So say we're given a circuit like this with a pretty high output impedance, but we want to drive a load with a pretty reasonable a kind of a low input impedance. We need a circuit that can go in here and intervene to keep the voltage roughly the same, but just boost the output impedance of this stage to drive the next stage. And this circuit there's a couple different versions of it. Today we'll introduce a single transistor version. Eventually we'll introduce basically an ideal op-amp version. But the circuit that you would put in here to make this work is called a follower. So it's just gonna follow the voltage that it sees, but hopefully the follower will have a much lower output impedance, a much lower internal resistance to drive the next stage of the circuit. All right, so any questions about that, the motivation? And I'll draw what this follower is and we'll analyze it. So the circuit that's going to do this is going to be the emitter follower. And it's actually quite simple. There's just our transistor here. And here we're going to connect the collector right up to our power supply. So for you, it's going to be connected up to 5 volts. And here you can have a emitter resistor. And this is basically going to be our load, the thing we attach it to. And we're going to have our V in here. V in. And the analysis of this circuit is really simple. So again, it's going to follow wiggles. So one, we wiggle V in by delta V in. Where's our output? I keep forgetting to draw the output of these circuits. The output of the circuit is going to be here. This is our output. Step two, we're pretty much done. Step two is that V out is going to be V in minus 0.6 volts because of this diode drop. And so delta V outs are going to equal delta V ins. And that's pretty much it. So we've followed the input. As the input goes up and down, this output goes up and down. And hopefully, we'll analyze it in a second. Hopefully this circuit will have a lower output impedance than a circuit that precedes it. And it'll act like a, well, okay, let me say it the other way. This follower should act like a big resistance, a big load, a big input impedance for the circuit that's driving it. And it should act like a very low output impedance, a very low battery internal resistance for the circuit that it's driving. And so let's just check that that's the case. Why might that be the case? Well, let me just write motivation number three. Remember, motivation number three is that if this is V out, then delta I out, the current through this resistor here, is going to be 1 plus beta times delta I in. So any current that's coming in here, the current that can be driven through this resistor is going to be, you know, 100, 200 times bigger than the current we need to put in. And so if you only need to put in a little bit of current, anything where you have a certain voltage, but you only need to put in a little bit of current, that acts like a pretty high resistance. And if you were to put in a little bit of current, you get a big boost of current out. Something that can provide a big boost of current acts like a pretty low output impedance. So that's the motivation. So let's actually derive this and see where this is coming from. So for that, I'm gonna draw a related version of this circuit. Let me just add on something to this circuit here. Let me add on a base resistor here. I'm going to make a slight modification. I'm just going to put a base resistor in here, and we'll see why in a second. So this base resistor is kind of like functioning as the output impedance of the previous stages voltage source. So let me get rid of some of this stuff here. Okay, so let me move V in to be here. Okay. So now let's ask, what is the follower's input impedance, Z in? So by follower, I mean just the transistor part of the circuit. So I'm gonna, first part of this analysis, I'm gonna put my black box around my follower. And I'm going to ask, what is my follower's input impedance? So how would I determine this? Well, one way to determine this is to measure here. This is the voltage at the base. If I model this dotted box as some V in RB, and then my dotted box here is going to be my input impedance of the follower, the thing I care about. So I'm replacing the whole transistor circuit by just a model. How would I measure it? Well, the way I would measure it is I would just try a bunch of different base resistors here and see, you know, for example, at what point does this VB become half of my VIN, right? If I find a base resistor where my VB is half of my VIN, then I found my input impedance. Now, of course, you don't have to keep trying more and more and more resistors until you get exactly half. You could just try a resistor that reduces it by some reasonable amount and then use the voltage divider equation to figure out what this Zn is. And what you'll find, and I'm not gonna go through this derivation, but what you'll find is that this Zn looks to be approximately beta times RE. So why is that? Well, if you were to just drive RE directly, you would need a certain amount of current. But since you're driving RE and most of the current is coming down from the top, you need only 1/100th, 1 beta-ith of the current that's going across RB. And if I need only 1/100th of the current to have the same effect on RE, it's as if RE looks beta times bigger. So that's why the input impedance of this follower looks big. It looks 100 times what it would be if you didn't bother with the follower. Now let's ask about the output impedance of the follower. And there I'm gonna redraw this circuit and draw different boxes because we're asking a different question. All right, so I'm gonna redraw exactly the same circuit. I'll draw it in a different color. Here's my VN. Ground. RB. Going into a transistor. RE. Out. Ground. Up to 5 volts. But now I'm gonna ask, what is the output impedance? Well, when I'm thinking about the output impedance, I'm really thinking about RE as the load. Well, maybe I shouldn't take it out here. I should just treat RE as my load. And I'm gonna ask, okay, so this is my load down here. I'm gonna separate my world into load and everything else. And I want to model this pink box. As just some V Thevenin. It's a V Thevenin like, but let me just say it's V, let me call it V Thevenin, even though we're dealing with more than just resistors. This will be evocative of simple Thevenins. connected to some Rth of an N that then comes out of the box. All right, so let's ask, ideally, if we make RE really big, not a lot of current is going to flow. And so our V Thevenin here, the voltage that you would see at this junction if we made RE extremely big, this is just going to be V in minus 0.6. So it's going to follow V in, but be a little bit lower. And now the question is, what is this R Thevenin? Well, again, the thing you're going to connect this box to is this is the load. Which is just RE. And you can measure this by just trying different REs and seeing where this voltage gets cut in half. Right? If I pick an RE that happens to be equivalent to this R Thevenin, then I know that I'll know that when the voltage gets cut in half compared to when RE is huge. So you can measure the output impedance of this thing by trying different loads. But let's argue what the output impedance should be in terms of RB. Well, if a certain amount of current flows here, i.e., in our model, there's nothing else going on. So we know that that same amount of current has to flow through this resistor, and there'll be some drop across that proportionally, right? Over here though, because there's this transistor here, if we have IE flowing here, going down, let me just draw it down here, IE going down, IB, the amount of current that's going through this resistor, is only 1/100th of the current going down here. This is IE over, it's actually beta plus one from our formulas earlier. So the amount of current going through this resistor is only 1/100th the amount of current going through this resistor. And so any voltage drop across this resistor because of this current is only going to be 1/100th or 1/betaeth, 1 beta plus once, beta plus first, you know, it's about 1/100th. It's going to be about 1/100th the voltage drop across this equivalent. So this resistor acts a lot like our RB resistor divided by beta. So it is, if we're stuck with a power supply or some other component that has a certain output impedance, RB, so here we have our real supply and our RB, we can insert this transistor, insert this follower, and we could shrink the output impedance by a factor of beta. And remember, low output impedance is good. It's like having a battery with a low internal resistance, that's good. So we win in both ways. To this power supply here, this resistor looks 100 times bigger, which is good. And to this resistor, the power supply has an internal resistance that's 100 times smaller, which is good. So you win in both directions. And today in the lab, you'll build this circuit and you'll measure the input and output impedance in this way. And you'll get an estimate for beta using that idea. So even though this circuit is the simplest of the circuits, I would say it's sort of the most subtle in terms of why it even exists and how to think about it. But that's all I'm going to say today. You should note that this lab number 4 is meant to take up 2 weeks. So you will probably mostly spend almost all of your time finishing the quiz and building this emitter follower and making all the measurements that it suggests. I would read my little commentary because I think that the way it suggests that you make measurements is not the clearest. So I've amended that a little bit. It's basically this, you know, you were supposed to redraw all these pictures, but with the actual resistors, and you're supposed to connect and disconnect this load and change the resistor until you see that when you connect the load, it falls by, you know, around a factor of two, and then you'll know what the output impedance is. And it's a little bit complicated because you have to take into account this shift. So you really, you want to put in a small sine wave and ask about the, when does the amplitude get squashed by a factor of two, so that you don't have to worry about this shift. All right, questions? I'm sure there are many.
I have a question.
Yes.
So like in terms of like scopy and connecting, because you have like the V in and 5 volts, like what goes where, like in terms of colored wires?
Okay, that's a good question. So let me go over to my overhead camera and I'll just, let me say a few things first and then I'll go over the overhead camera. So your breadboard has these horizontal rails and you really confine yourself to one little region. So there's some rails on the top, a region with where you put stuff, and then two rails on the bottom. So let's just say that these are the middle trough. I think what you want is you want to make this your -5 volts. This is the white wire. You want to make this one ground. And you want to make either one of these, it doesn't matter. I usually do this one, +5 volts. And that's the red wire. And your signal input, your yellow wire, should just go, it should never go on a rail. So whenever you have a constant voltage, you want to put it on a rail because you get this extra capacitance, which is good. And you have a signal, like some sinusoid or triangle wave or something, you don't want to put it on a rail because you have this extra capacitance, which is bad. So your yellow wire will just go somewhere in one of these rows of five. And you'll build your circuit here. So this is your sinusoidal yellow wire. And this will be basically true for the rest of the class. So you'll hook up all your ground wires to here. You'll hook up your white wire and your -5 supply to here. You'll hook up your red constant +5 supply here. And your yellow will always go wherever you need an input. And then orange and blue, your probe wires, they go wherever you need to go to probe what you need to probe. Okay, I'm back with my overhead camera. As you can see, I've got a circuit that's much more complicated. I have a bunch of transistors in here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 transistors. But they're all on this middle trough. You know, on either side of this middle trough. And my red wire is connected to the top rail of that trough. I have a whole bunch of black wires, which are all ground. They all go onto this next rail. And my white wire, my -5 volt supply, is connected to the bottom rail. And then everything else just sort of hangs down from the top and hangs up from the bottom. And my signal wires and measurement wires just come in on these much smaller smaller sets of five. And the first thing you're supposed to do is to test some of your transistors. So let me grab a transistor to test at random here. And if you haven't already set this up, now is the time. Stick this in, you clip it down, the little clip, and you hit the button, and it'll tell you, okay, this one's a PNP transistor, which is not the kind we've talked about. We've always talked about NPN transistors. It'll tell you the pinout here, pins 1, 2, and 3, and what's what, which one's the base, which one's the collector, which one's the emitter. It gives an estimate for the beta, which it calls HFE. So you can use this to get which pins are which, or you can look at the top of your kit, which has a picture here that says which pins are which for the transistors. And eventually we'll use all of these chips, but for now we're just looking at basically just this first transistor today. All right. I'm gonna unplug this camera and I'm gonna run upstairs for a little bit. So if you have questions, I'll be back in a few minutes after this freight train goes by.